Hi everyone, it's Dr. Romani, and welcome back to this YouTube channel on narcissism, narcissistic abuse, and all kinds of stuff relevant to difficult, toxic relationships. It's my hope that this content and this channel will help you cope, heal, and just understand these relationships a little bit better. Now, throughout the month of May, we're featuring videos on a range of mental health conditions to provide some basic education on this range of issues, as well as to tie these mental health issues to both narcissistic abuse and narcissism. And today, we'll be talking about borderline personality disorder. Keep in mind, this is not at all an exhaustive examination at these other mental health disorders. Those would take hours. So it's sort of an overview, but then tying these patterns into narcissism and narcissistic abuse so you can see the linkages and place these in a greater context if you're looking at it from those perspectives. Now, borderline personality disorder has a lot of relationship to narcissism in general, and you're going to see, even as I describe borderline personality styles in general, you'll see where some of the overlaps are, but you're also going to see where it's quite distinct. Borderline personality disorder is really characterized by one word, and that one word is instability. It's instability in identity, instability in how a person views themselves, instability in a person's goals, instability in relationships, instability in emotions. And then that instability is also accompanied by other behavioral issues such as impulsivity, risk-taking, and chronic manifestations of hostility and difficulties with anger management. When we look at the overall symptomatology of borderline personality disorder, we're looking at patterns such as abandonment is a major issue. People with borderline personality are frequently engaging in frantic efforts to avoid any form of abandonment, real or imagined. There's a pattern of very unstable interpersonal relationships, and these relationships tend to be characterized by going between two sorts of poles, between an extreme of idealizing somebody, they're the best thing that ever happened to them, and utter devaluation, but a lot of going between the two. Another common element of borderline personality that we see is disturbances in identity. A person with this personality style will have a very unstable sense of self and a very unstable just general self-image. We tend to see impulsivity, and impulsivity can be in a variety of areas, and usually areas that are self-damaging. This would be things like risky sex with potentially dangerous partners, reckless driving, substance use, indiscriminate spending, having discontrolled behavior with food, that sort of thing. We can see recurrent suicidal behavior, recurrent suicidal gestures, recurrent suicidal threats, or self-harming behavior, for example, self-mutilation. We tend to see overall emotional instability, and this most likely manifests through a reactivity of mood. So the person has very strong emotional reactions to situations, and this can be intense episodes of depression, intense episodes of irritability, and these can last for just a few hours all the way to a few days. People who have borderline personality styles will often say that they feel empty. There will be issues with being at major difficulty with controlling anger. They can have inappropriate, intense anger and lots of trouble controlling or holding back on displays of that anger. And in some cases, you can also see what we call transient means sort of passing stress, paranoid ideation due to stress. So that's the kind of thing where a person really starts to feel paranoid, and that gets intensified under conditions of stress, really feeling that people are out to harm them, out to get them, or you might even see dissociative symptoms in people with borderline personality when they're under stress. So as you can see, this is generally a pattern of instability, anger, acting out, and despair. Now, when we think about borderline personality disorder in line with narcissistic abuse, let's start by talking about what happens when a person who has borderline personality style is in a narcissistically abusive relationship. In a word, it is a volatile, very messy, potentially very dangerous situation. The narcissistic relationship, as we know, has this cycle, right? Love bombing, devaluation, discarding. Can you imagine how that plays out for somebody who really, really struggles with abandonment? So as a result, when a person with a borderline personality style gets into a relationship with somebody who has a very strong narcissistic personality style, you'll see numerous volatile crises play out around abandonment, around how different shows of cruelty from one to the other, very strong outbursts of emotion. These relationships can be so volatile that it's actually quite dangerous for children to witness them or be in the presence of them. Sometimes they can escalate to violence, but there's a tremendous amount of chaos, and the narcissistic abuse can actually culminate in significant crisis for a person who has borderline personality and frequently feels abandoned in a relationship with a narcissistic partner or in a relationship characterized by narcissistic abuse. Both, when we see people who are narcissistic and we see people with borderline personality styles, we see that dysregulation, right? And that dysregulation can really play out. So in fact, when people are in a relationship with somebody with borderline personality, they'll report that the impacts of the dysregulation really take a toll on them. There's another interesting overlap, is that there are overlaps in terms of abandonment. Abandonment is an issue for people who are narcissistic. Abandonment is a very big issue for people with borderline personality. And as a result, you'll really see the sort of approach avoidance style. People who really go in and almost get like too intensely enmeshed with each other. And then they, as soon as they feel like they're getting too close, somebody always runs away. The other one tries to pull the other one back. And it really seems almost like this senseless, chaotic carousel of breaking up and getting back together, breaking up and getting back together. Because people who are narcissistic are so contemptuous, that contemptuousness for anybody really stings. It feels awful because it really does feel like someone's almost disgusted with us. Well, in situations of narcissistic abuse, that sort of contemptuous, rejecting, disgusted emotion that gets expressed, if a person with borderline symptomatology is in a narcissistically abusive relationship, just that contemptuous disregard can trigger those abandonment symptoms and an abandonment crisis. The suicidal acting out that is not uncommon in borderline personality can make these relationships very dangerous when they're characterized by narcissistic abuse. Because what can often happen is that the abandonment crisis can set off suicidal acting out, suicidal gestures, suicidal thoughts. Because abandonment crises are such a classical part of a narcissistically abusive relationship, that can set off these suicidal crises more and more often. And there's a real danger to that, that an attempt could escalate to the point, obviously, where a person could lose their life or do such significant harm to themselves that it cannot be turned back. It could do severe damage to themselves physically, for example. So in a nutshell, narcissistic abuse within the context of borderline personality is really, really a messy, potentially dangerous clinical space. Now, when we think about narcissism and borderline personality disorder, there are definitely overlaps. If we were to look at all the personality disorders sort of on a related continuum, borderline and narcissistic personalities are contiguous. They touch each other. Theoreticians like Otto Kernberg, quite frankly, when he described, and he's a major theoretician when it comes to narcissism and narcissistic personality disorder. If you read his writings, the way he describes narcissism and narcissistic personality, it actually resembles borderline personality as its list is described in the DSM. So the overlap has often been well known. What we do see, for example, in borderline personality is a real variability in empathy. There are times when there's no significant stress present and where there's not an abandonment crisis being activated. A person with borderline personality actually will often have excessive empathy, be deeply attuned to other people, very caring, almost to a fault, like where they're actually giving up too much of themselves to be present for another. However, when stress or abandonment or some other crisis gets activated, that empathy really dissipates. It's as though then the person's entirely focused on trying to stave off abandonment, and then it can turn into a place of rage. And that rage isn't always rage out at other people in borderline personality. It can also be rage inward, which is where we hear the terrible negative things that people with borderline personality will say about themselves or think about themselves, or the self-harming behavior. But there can be some overlap. When we look at what I call sort of pure borderline personality styles, we see a lot of despair. We see a lot of internal pain, the ability to express that pain, a sense of helplessness with the symptomatology, wishing there was a way to address it, very aware of the harm this is causing to other people, almost sometimes actually quite insightful at moments of what we call lucidity, when they'll say, I recognize what I'm doing is not okay, and I'm going to burn this relationship up with all my fears that you're cheating on me or going away from me or abandoning me. I'm aware of that, and I'm so sorry for all the chaos I'm causing. That's the kind of reflection you can hear from somebody with pure borderline. It starts getting messy when both borderline and narcissistic symptoms are present in the same individual. When you see both narcissistic and borderline symptoms in the same person, we may see less insight, much more externalized anger, the screaming, the yelling, the raging at others, more manipulative behavior, more entitlement, subsequently more boundary violations, still that despair, but a lot of other patterns that are interpersonally much, much more challenging. So yes, there is a relationship between the two. And again, this gets into much, much deeper theoretical musings about this topic. But when you really think of it as a continuum, pure narcissism, we know that, the lack of empathy, entitlement, arrogance, all that, pure borderline, very despairing, but that overlap can often result in this rather panicky, angry, acting out, manipulative style that is often, interestingly, often viewed in line with how a lot of people think of borderline personality, but in fact is a little bit different. It's not that pure type. That's much, much more despair-oriented. Now, when we think about the treatment of borderline personality disorder, actually, the treatment outcomes here may be better than they are for any personality disorder there is. Marsha Linehan's work in the development of dialectical behavior therapy has definitely shown some good outcomes, and particularly on the more severe elements of borderline personality, such as emotional regulation around suicidal behavior. There's been numerous clinical studies that show that the use of DBT, the dialectical behavior therapy, with people who have borderline personality or borderline personality disorder does decrease the number of suicidal attempts and events. Cognitive behavioral therapy has also been shown to be useful, helping people understand better their thoughts and their beliefs and their subsequent behavior. This idea, for example, a person with borderline personality can really, really assume that people are going to leave them and then communicate with another person as though they are when they're not, teaching people about those patterns. Medications are often brought to bear in borderline personality. People who prescribe medications may use a combination of things, including antidepressants, mood stabilizing medications, antipsychotic medications, and anti-anxiety medications. For that, you'd have to see a psychiatrist or a psychiatric nurse practitioner who can engage in more education specific to the symptoms somebody's having to come up with sort of the perfect medication balance, if that's what's indicated. And there's always a need for long-term psychotherapy. This is not something that's going to be knocked out in 5 or 6 or 8 or 10 sessions. This is often longer-term clinical work, a combination of individual therapy, group therapy, doing long-term work, doing work between sessions and workbooks and homework and all of that. So it's a long-term commitment. However, it does work, and many people who really have the right treatment for borderline personality really do see changes. They're able to regulate emotion better and manage relationships in a better way. Another important piece of borderline personality disorder is that the vast majority of people with borderline personality disorder have a co-occurring mental health condition, like a mood disorder or an anxiety disorder or a substance use disorder. So a big part of the treatment is also managing those co-occurring conditions, which can get worse in light of having co-occurring borderline personality occurring with them. And for more information on borderline personality, we've provided some resources in the video notes. Please go there, and I hope that those links are useful. I hope this video is useful and helped you understand borderline personality disorder in context of narcissism and narcissistic abuse. The relationships between these two are often misunderstood by people, and I hope this video was helpful. Thank you.